This screencast involves the analysis of differential reactor data to fill in some missing cells in this chart that's shown here. Rows 1 through 5 of this chart show a series of measurements that were done with 10 milligrams of catalyst at the same flow rate of reactants and the same temperature, and we're just varying the partial pressures of our two reactants and measuring the flow rate out of a product where our reaction expression is shown here, A plus 2B going to C plus D. And we want to take advantage of the fact that this is a differential reactor in order to sort of go step by step and do the analysis required to fill in these missing cells. What we can see in this row is that, again, we have all the same elements as above, except for we have a new partial pressure of B, and we have an unknown partial pressure of A for the reactants, and we need to solve for the flow rate of the product, C, out. And so what we can do is use the data that's shown above row 6 in order to determine this, since we have all of these parameters to the left being the same, and we're only varying the partial pressures of our two reactants and seeing how the rate of formation of the product responds to that. And so to do this problem, we can write a material balance on component C, where basically the flow rate of C out of the reactor minus what we flow in, and here we're not flowing anything in, is equal to the rate with which C is produced in the reactor times the amount of catalyst over which it's produced, if this rate is defined on a per mass of catalyst basis, as is implied by the fact that we're keeping track of the mass of catalyst that we're actually using in the reaction. And the nice thing about a differential reactor is the conditions are not changing in the reactor. They're remaining at very close to the inlet conditions. And so for a differential reactor, this reaction rate is a constant term. And so we don't have to worry about any spatial variations in the reactor. And we might postulate that the rate follows a power rate law form, where we have the rate is proportional to the partial pressures raised to some powers for both of the reactants. And so we can multiply that by a rate constant, and then we carry along the catalyst mass. And so if we look at the data above, we can basically, by inspection, see that we can take several points where the partial pressure of A is constant. So we can take the row 2, row 4, and row 5, and the partial pressure of A doesn't vary there. And in those rows, the partial pressure of B goes from 40 to 60 to 80, but the rate of product formation does not change. It stays at 0.32 micromoles per hour. And so therefore, we know that the rate does not depend on the partial pressure of B. In other words, beta is equal to 0. And so this term just becomes a 1. We neglect any dependence on the partial pressure of B according to this data. Right, as far as the partial pressure of A, what we see is that as we, for example, at constant partial pressure of B, as we double the partial pressure of A from 40 to 80, then the rate goes up also by a factor of 2. And we can observe that for a couple of data points. So when it goes up from 40 to 60, it goes up by a factor of about 1.5. And so therefore, we expect that alpha is approximately equal to 1. And so this is now our material balance, where we've figured out the values of alpha and beta. The flow rate of the product out is equal to a rate constant times the partial pressure of A times a catalyst mass. And so here, if we look now at row 6, what we can see is that what's changed relative to row 1, for example, is that the partial pressure of B has gone up, but that doesn't affect the rate. And the rate has gone up by a factor of 0.37 over 0.21. And we know that the catalyst mass hasn't changed. It's still 10 milligrams. The rate constant hasn't changed because the temperature is the same. Okay, and so therefore, Fc in row 6 divided by Fc in row 1, which is 0.37 over 0.21, has to be equal to the partial pressure that was used in row 6 divided by the partial pressure of component A in row 1, based again on this linear relationship between Fc and Pa. If we solve for Pa, we get a value of approximately 70 kilopascals. And so we can plug that in right up here at the top. The next row, what we see is that the rate is, again, it's about the same. It's 0.38 micromoles per hour. And all of the different data points are the same as in row 1, except for the catalyst mass. So all the conditions are the same. And so if we go back again and look at our balance shown here, Right, then we say that between rho 1 and rho 7, the temperature is the same, and so the rate constant will be the same. The partial pressure of A is the same. It's 40 kilopascals in both cases. And so the catalyst mass has to have changed enough to make the flow rate of C out increase by the observed amount. And so again, because of the linear relationship between FC and W, we expect the catalyst mass for rho 7 divided by the catalyst mass for rho 1 should be equal to the flow rate of product for rho 7 divided by the flow rate of product for rho 1. That flow rate of product is 0.38 divided by 0.21. This catalyst mass for rho 1 was 10 milligrams. And so therefore, solving for the catalyst mass in rho 7, we get a value of 18 milligrams. We need to determine rho 8. And if we look at rho 8, the only thing that's changed compared to rho 1 is that the total flow rate, the total molar flow rate, which is given in standard cubic centimeters per minute, is doubled. And everything else, the temperature and the partial pressures, are the same. And if we go to look at, again, our material balance equation, we see that the total inlet flow rate of the reactant stream actually doesn't factor into our material balance at all. And that's because we're achieving differential conversion regardless. And so it doesn't matter what flow rate we actually put in, that it would affect what our overall conversion is, but it doesn't affect the flow rate of product because the flow rate of product only depends on the concentration that's in the reactor. And that's only affected by the partial pressure of A. And so the total flow rate into the reactor actually has no effect on this outlet flow rate of the product. And so, therefore, we can go back up and say that the rate here should be the same as in row 1 because there's no dependence on the total flow rate. So that's equal to 0.21. All right, in the last row, row 9, all of the cells are the same as row 1, except the temperature has gone up from 200 to 240 degrees C. And so we need to take that into account using this activation energy of 88.1 kilojoules per mole. We again go to our material balance equation. In this case, between rho 1 and rho 7, the partial pressures of A are the same at 40 kilopascal. The catalyst mass is the same in both cases at 10 milligrams. And so K is the only thing that's changing, and so we can predict the outlet flow rate of the product C based on that change in K. So we can say that the flow rate of C for rho 9 divided by the flow rate of C for rho 1 is equal to that same ratio of rate constants because of the linear relationship shown above. And so the ratio of two rate constants at different temperatures is given by the exponential of the negative activation energy over R times the quantity 1 over T9 minus 1 over T1, where that T9 is the absolute temperature in row 9, and that T1 is the absolute temperature in row 1. So we can just plug in different values. All right, the T1 is 200 degrees C, which is 473 K. T9 is 240 degrees C, which is 513 K. The activation energy was given as 88.1 kilojoules per mole. And then our gas constant that we can use would be 8.314 times 10 to the minus 3 kilojoules per mole Kelvin. And finally, FC, we've used this many times before, that's just equal to 0.21 in the units that are given in the table. And so finally, we can solve for FC in row 9, and what I get from plugging in these values is that the rate goes up significantly with this 40 degrees C increase in temperature from 0.21 all the way up to about 1.2. So we see that basically we can fill out what we expect for these missing cells by using the data that are given above in order to determine a reaction rate mechanism and then determine a reaction kinetic expression and use that reaction kinetic expression to analyze ratios of rates for rows 6 through 9.